Okay, welcome to a special broadcast of the Lovecraft eZine Talk Show. Today is Friday, September the 18th, 2015. Usually we do this on Sundays, but Dark Regents Press did a raffle. You can probably explain this better than me, Chris, but some lucky winners got to send in some questions for Laird Barron. So, of course, we have Laird Barron with us. And hey, the guy without a face there is Chris Morey.
Yep, that's me.
You want to talk about the raffle for a second, Chris?
Sure, yeah. Basically, the idea was that we would have people contribute any amount to our current Kickstarter campaign for our project called I Am the Abyss. And in the raffle, they're also asked to ask a question, an interview question for Laird. And we decided to choose 10 winners that would also be awarded signed and personalized hardcover books from Laird, as well as having their questions asked live during this chat. And we also decided to choose 5 runner-ups. So overall, there will be 15 questions that were crowdsourced from this raffle. And I think it was kind of a fun opportunity for a lot of Laird's fans to kind of gather together and build their own little interview for him. So.
Yeah. And plus, it'll be one of the easiest interviews I've ever done, because all I have to do is read the questions, or half the questions, you read the other half.
Absolutely, yeah. We'll go back and forth, and Laird will answer the questions, and I'm sure some discussions will result, and should be a good time.
Well, Laird, welcome to the show. Chris, welcome. We can get right into the questions. Real quick before we do that, why don't we talk about I Am the Abyss, that Kickstarter and that book, which has started all this. You want to talk about that briefly, Chris?
Sure, yeah. That's an anthology project that I've been working on for a couple years now, and the concept is essentially the personal afterlife. The idea is that after we die, our consciousness inverts into our own realms of subconscious thought. So essentially, the afterlife is our manifestations of our own memories and the deepest parts of our character. And what I was hoping for with the book was to really get some adventurous stories, some really kind of fantastic and just, you know, you're really diving in deep with these things. Like, you just get lost in these underworlds. But then at the same time, I wanted really some really good introspective, some full of revelations, some really deep stories that kind of get into the character of these people. And the fiction that I've received so far has been, bar none, some of the best I've read for a project that I worked on with Dark Greens Press. And I'm very pleased that Laird is also in the process of working on a novella for the book, which is why we're doing this whole raffle thing and why he's associated with the project. And yeah, the talent that we have involved with this project, I couldn't be more thrilled about. The authors, the artists, everybody's just amazing. And we've got 4 days left. It's on Kickstarter in the publishing category. And it's doing fairly well, and we're going for stretch goals now. We've reached our funding goal, so trying to get it over the top now.
When approximately will the book be out?
The book will be out next year. It'll be a fourth quarter release of 2016. And realistically, with the scale of this project, I would say near the end of the fourth quarter. I'm really trying to under-promise on this one, because I just know from, you know, this project is just so chock full of, so it's all original. Every novella and every piece of artwork created for this book is 100% original and newly created for the project. And when you have this many authors and this many artists that all have, you know, their own workloads, their own schedules, there's going to be delays inevitably. But we're going to work our asses off to make sure fourth quarter of 2016 is when campaign backers will have it in their hands. So.
Yeah, so you've got Laird, Caitlin Kiernan, Jeffrey Thomas, a bunch of other people.
A lot of Lovecraft using favorites, exactly. You got a lot of really great authors in there.
Well, why don't we dive into these questions for Laird? You were going to take the first one, right?
Yes, sir, absolutely. And that one is from Jed Lackritz. And so, Jed, congratulations. You are the first winner, by the way. And I suppose we can just start with the Coyne for the prizes. So he'll win the signed and personalized hardcover of the Coyne from Laird. And we'll do 4 more winners of that, and then 5 winners of The Beautiful Thing That Awaits Us All for signed and personalized hardcovers. So Jed's question is, Are there any writers of strange stories, weird fiction, or horror whose work you think deserves to have greater influence on the genre?
I could go on all night. There are, especially after reading for Mike Kelly's Year's Best Weird Fiction last year, there are scores of wonderful writers working in this field right now. A couple that I'd like to mention, one would be John Langan. John's a friend of mine, and we became friends primarily because I, even, you know, back when he had only published a couple stories, I was just really in awe of his skill. We both appeared in the magazine of fantasy and science fiction back in the early 2000s, I think within a few weeks of each other, actually, within an issue or two. And John's just gotten better and better. He's classically trained, he's an academic, and he's very heavily influenced by the classics, the Jameses, M.R., and Henry. But one of the things that make him such a powerful voice in the field, and somebody I think deserves more coverage, is just that he's constantly taking his ability to dissect the classical tropes and the conventions of the genre and repurpose them and reimagine them in ways that are very striking and very singular. I highly recommend his current and latest collection, The Wide Carnivorous Sky and Other Monstrous Geographies. It's, you know, it fulfills the promise of his first collection that came out a few years ago, and a novel that came out, I think, 2009 or 10, and doubles down on him. Another writer that people need to be reading if they're interested in this kind of thing is Livia Llewellyn. Livia Llewellyn is absolutely courageous, formidable, ferocious writer. Her writing is, it's and I love it partially because it totally upends Lovecraftian and a lot of classical weird sort of repression issues. She takes basically the chastity and repression sexuality of, you know, classical, what you'll find in Mach and Blackwood, especially Lovecraft, and she just shreds all that. And I wouldn't classify her as a Lovecraftian author by any means. I mean, she's got a lot more of a range than that, but it is delightful to read, you know, to read her material that veers into the Lovecraftian or the Clark Ashton Smith territory, and just basically just, you know, would make them blush. And one more person who I know they're going to break through any minute now. I can't say too much about it, but I know they've got big things coming their way, is Stephen Graham Jones. Stephen Graham Jones, I think if I were forced to, you know, make a list of the top 10 best writers of the fantastic alive today, he would have to be in there somewhere. His collections are just absolutely masterful. I mean, I love his novels, but the man is a genius with a stream of consciousness, sort of off the cuff, raw kind of a style. And he's another academic. I believe he teaches in Colorado. He's a professor there, but he just has this informal, flowing kind of a style that just sweeps you along with it, and there's a precision, there's this underlying precision in this weird stuff that he does, and it's all the more remarkable for the fact that he's more prolific than probably any three or four other weird fiction authors that I'm aware of. He puts out a lot of material, and it's uniformly crisp and well done. And like I said, there's many, many, many others. I could talk about Paul Tremblay, who just, you know, wrote A Head Full of Ghosts, and there's Scott Nicolay, and there's Simon Strances, and Richard Gavin. There's Gemma Files. I'm actually reading her upcoming novel. There's just, I can go on for a long time, but those first three would be at the top of my list.
Yeah, you mentioned Gemma Files just now. I am really enjoying experimental film.
Absolutely, right.
Yeah, what a...
And another collection I just reviewed is T. E. Grau's, hope I'm pronouncing his last name right, The Nameless Dark. And he's a very new, he's only been, you know, John and Stephen Graham Jones and Lydia have been around, you know, well over 10 years, which still in this business kind of qualifies as fairly new. But T.E.'s very, you know, Ted's very new. He's been on the scene for about 3 years that I'm aware of. And this novel came out, or excuse me, this collection, The Nameless Dark, just came out from Letha. Steve Berman is the owner-operator of Letha, and I really want to commend him because Steve brought out Libby Llewellyn, he brought out Will Ludwigson, In Search of Others last year, absolutely genius level short fiction collection. So I really want to commend Steve and Letha Press for the, you know, for the hard work and just the great savvy eye for bringing out this sort of truly weird off-kilter material.
Yeah, Ted actually came to meet with that collection originally, and at the time, it was sort of a turbulent time for DRP, and I wasn't sure how we were going to pursue with collections, but from everything that I've, all the reviews that I've read, it's been getting a very positive response, and I kind of kick myself sometimes, but you know, I know Ted, and he's a great guy and a great writer, and John Langan is another man that that we've worked with recently, and
You're bringing out like a deluxe edition of his collection or something like that, right?
Yeah, deluxe slipcase edition of The White Carnivorous Sky, and we're getting some really great illustrations from an artist named Ian Hindley, and man, it's really coming together beautifully, and I think that there's only a few copies actually remain, so definitely swooped them up quick.
John Langan sent me a short story that you've read, Laird, called Anchor.
Yes.
For the upcoming Autumn Cthulhu, and I waited and waited on that story, which he knows. It was worth the wait, which you know too.
I stuck in with a spear a couple times.
I know you did.
It finally worked.
But man, that is a hell of a novella. And
you're right. It's one of the best he's ever done.
Yeah.
I think this is one of those cases where it's not, you know, it's not glib to say it was worth the wait. This, you know, because I was on his case. I said, hey, you really need to get that in. And he goes, just let me, you know, I'm having not troubles with it, but just sometimes it takes longer than you think. And damn, I was blown away. You know, because it's one of those syndromes where, you know, I know him, and so I'm kind of inured to the whole, there's really not a lot of a filter. So I, you know, I'm like, oh, I hear John's voice when I read it. And I'm like, oh, okay, this blew me away. It blew me away. It had such a profound effect on me, you know, as his friend. I think it's going to be a major story in the community next year.
I do, too. I can't wait for a lot of other people to read it. Okay, so our second question, and you can tell us who what they won, I guess, Chris, but Heath Wolfeld, Heath's question is... Or what's T1 in? Let's cover that first real quick, Chris.
Let's just, for the next four people, we'll just keep doing the croning, sign and personalized hardcovers.
Okay, his question is, what was it like to race the Iditarod? Am I saying that right? Has the experience had any impact on your writing?
Yes. It's kind of hard to articulate what it was like because it's a two-week experience, and you're under a lot of, you and the animals are under a lot of stress. And you cover seven mountain ranges. You travel up the Yukon River. My rookie year, I almost got, you know, we almost died in a storm, a blizzard. And so there's, you know, to encompass it all, it's very difficult. As far as how it impacted my writing, it impacted it to the degree that I've been writing my entire life, and I've been writing professionally for about 16 years or so. And up until the last 3 or 4 years, I've only danced around, you know, Alaska stories, and specifically the Iditarod. You know, there was one story early in my career where the villain went up to Alaska, but it was just kind of glossed over. My life in Alaska, and specifically the Iditarod, had this such a sort of scarifying effect that I just, until recently, I haven't wanted to touch it. It was one of those things it informed me. It informed everything that I do, but it wasn't something that I could look at directly and talk about, at least in the context of writing stories about it. You know, and I've been, and I knew it would come up sooner or later. It's just such a big part of my, you know, first 20, 25 years of my life. But I think the Adivinod itself has less of an impact on my writing compared to the training, the year-round training that I endured and committed to for the Adivinod. That had far more. The lifestyle had a greater impact. And what I've gleaned from that lifestyle is a lot of patience. And on a couple levels. One, just the discipline to get up every day without supervision and pursue your goal. You know, it's not a regular job. You don't have a boss standing over you. You are the boss. And the goals are very intangible a lot of the time. And so you go out there, you strap on your mucklucks, and you get the dogs out, and you go do it. And it's, you know, I estimate conservatively I spent around or traveled about 40,000 miles in the back of a dog team over the years. And that's a lot, you know, over about a 15-year period. And that's a lot of time to be spending on the back of, a team out in the middle of nowhere with just you and your Huskies.
Yeah.
And it allowed me to a lot of time to think about who I wanted to be. And it inured me to boredom. But mostly, in retrospect, it taught me that there are, in a secular sense, and possibly a spiritual sense, that there are things much bigger than ourselves. That you can be part of it, whether you like it or not, you probably are part of it, but you don't have as much control as you think. That whole lifestyle, you know, it's a strange contradiction. You have utter control over the lives of your team, and to a degree yourself. You're usually carrying a weapon, and it's very much a frontier lifestyle. At least the way that I lived. I mean, I lived in a cabin in the middle of nowhere when I trained my team, you know, in my late teens or through my early 20s. And yet, you have routine. We travel these trails every day. We check these trap lines. We hunt for moose. We do whatever, and it's sort of a ritualized existence. But you're always at the mercy of falling through the ice, a windstorm springing up that you didn't anticipate, being attacked by wildlife, possibly people, and you're kind of at the mercy of these things. Illness that sweeps through the dog team, and so it taught me that all you can really do is keep moving forward, work as hard as you possibly can, and try to basically dig ditches for fortune, as Machiavelli said. You can't control the flood, but you can dig the ditches, and that's what I got out of it ultimately, is digging those ditches, and when the flood comes, hoping to be able to ride it out.
So perhaps the vastness of the Alaska wilderness sort of influence your love for cosmic horror and weird fiction to some respects?
Well, absolutely, and I think one of the other questions touches on that. But yes, I think the question, one of the other questions about wilderness is a sense of place. But you're absolutely, and we can get into that more later.
For sure, and I'll just jump on to the next question then. So the next question comes from one Adam Alexander. So he'll be getting a copy of The Cronin, Sign of Personalized Hardcover. His question is, to what degree do you see the importance of place in your writing? Is the setting a character in itself?
I think the best weird fiction often has, and not just weird fiction, because my background is Western, science fiction, whatever, but sense of place seems to permeate the stuff that I grew up, that I loved when I grew up, stepping away from this genre. You know, look at Robert Service, the famous poet. Everything, his most popular poetry, dealt with the Yukon ballads and the Alaska ballads, and he personified it, anthropomorphized it consistently, and I think that there's something to that. You read Cormac McCarthy, the sense of place is, especially like in Blood Meridian, you know, we're actors on this big stage, and this big stage, though, is sort of a living, it's a living stage. And in my own work, in my own experience from Alaska, you know, forget about the work, I'm a fairly open-minded person, but I'm not religious, and I don't consider myself extraordinarily superstitious. I try to be agnostic about things. I'm open to the idea that there are things I don't understand, undreamt of in my philosophy, as the bard said. But Alaska, and especially rural Alaska, whether it's just some primordial piece of the hindbrain that just activates. In other words, maybe there's nothing external going on. Maybe it's just the hindbrain starts reacting to the environment. Maybe there's some electromagnetics. Who knows? But it is very easy to, and we're stepping past seasonal, affective disorder, so-called cabin fever. There is really it's very tempting to personify the environment. There's sort of an inimical atmosphere to some regions, more so than others. But Alaska has an inordinately high rate of suicide, alcoholism, and violence per capita. Part of that is, I think, the day-night cycle is very whack for most people. In the summer, it's 23 hours a day of light at its peak. In the wintertime, you might have, like 4 or 5 hours of daylight, 5 hours of daylight, depending on where you live. And that really does affect people, the sense of isolation. But the places where I've had the most sort of odd experiences that I think have informed my writing philosophy, at least in respect to horror and cosmic horror specifically, has to do with not being so much isolated or stuck in my cabin, because that certainly wasn't the case with my life. I was out traveling. It's just you're traveling along a river somewhere in the interior, a frozen river, middle of the winter, and you just experience this. I experience this overwhelming sense of not being welcome. And when I conferred with my comrades, fellow mushers, some of them big game hunters, real rowdy, roughneck, salt of the earth guys who've been doing it for a long time, they had experienced the same thing in the same spots on the trail. So that, and also in their own, some of them lived in very remote regions the rest of the year. And so Alaska has, if nothing else, it seems to have some sort of personality. And I'm proud to have lived there. I think that it was a very formative experience for me. But I would stress that I'm proud, and happy to have lived there, as opposed to wanting to live there again.
Our next question comes from Edwin Labes, if I'm saying your last name right, Edwin. Laird, when did you know you wanted to become a storyteller, and why?
I started writing when I was about 5. And I didn't learn to read until I was around 6. And so I sort of created my own runic alphabet. I mean, it was gibberish, and then I drew pictures to sort of convey articulate the story. But I had this need to write before I could actually even read. And I wrote my first story in second grade. That's when I basically knew. I wrote, my second grade teacher, Mrs. Gray, she assigned us all a paragraph, write a paragraph, anything you want, just fiction. And I went home over the weekend and I wrote, I can't remember how big it was. It was like around 2,000 words. And you're talking about a 7-year-old kid. So she typed it up, and it was just this horrible little story. But, she was sort of blown away, and her reaction to it was encouraging. She was actually, out of all the teachers ever had, she was the only one who was ever actually maybe the other ones were trying to do me a favor. They knew what was going to happen. But, she was extremely encouraging about my professed, I wanted to be an author, and I told her that. I didn't know what that really meant. I just knew that I didn't understand the concept of books, really, even though I was reading at that time. I just knew that I wanted to make, you know, to create stories. And I found out years later, I had no idea at the time, that my grandfather had been a failed novelist. And although, you know, I didn't understand that concept either, but I mean, I understood that he had been submitting for years, since the 60s. And he had struck up a relationship, and I don't remember who it is. I want to say the guy's name was Garfield, and I would have to hunt that down. But he struck up a relationship with a well-published, like, historical men's adventure kind of author who critiqued his... My grandfather wrote, I mean, many novels, from what I can tell. I found them in boxes years later, and I read some of the correspondence between this, the actual author and my grandfather. And so, you know, obviously it ran in the blood. There was something genetic there. But my grandfather never talked to me about writing. When I started writing, he just kind of shrugged. He was very much like my father in that regard. He was like, oh, that's, you know, that's nice. I think by that time, we're talking, you know, mid-70s. I think my grandfather had not had anything published in like 15 years. Had tried. He was probably pretty bitter about it. But I don't have any other relatives. I have on my mom's side, my uncle is a poet and a songwriter, you know. But it isn't really, you know, both of my brothers, I have two younger brothers, and both of them, if they chose to pursue it, I believe would be dynamite writers. They have great imaginations and great skill, but this degree of sort of persistence is really only man, you know, I'm the only one that, you know, and I've been lucky to have some success at it. But I do think it somehow, you know, was in the blood.
Yeah, persistence really is key with writing too. One of my favorite lines from Ray Bradbury is, if you don't write for one day, you'll notice. If you don't write for 2 days, your critics will notice. If you don't write for 3 days, your audience will notice. And, you know, obviously I did a little writing myself, and I just found if I stopped for even a couple days, all of a sudden I could see a little bit of rust around the edges there. And it's just amazing how really you have to stay on top of it. So I admire that kind of persistence, Laird.
Yeah, another Bradbury quote is he didn't understand what other writers did with their time when he looked at his output. So,
yeah.
I think you got the next question, Chris.
Okay, let's see what we got. Robert Adams. Okay, and he will be the last person to win the Croning. And his question is, okay, now this is the one that was cut off a little bit, Laird, so I hope that you can kind of gather it from the partial question here. So,
right.
I feel like The Light is the Darkness offered closure of sorts to the transhuman themed stories from the, how do you pronounce this, Laird? I'm sorry, the Imago sequence.
There's two ways to pronounce it. I pronounce it Imago.
Imago.
You can also call it Imago.
Imago sequence. However, some of your later stories, like Jaws of Saturn and The Worms Crawl In, and even The Man with No Name, to a certain degree, also involve characters who undergo ...
Right, and I'm interpreting that, or extrapolating, I should say, that, you know, where am I going? You know, he thought basically I'd wrapped it up in that short novel that I wrote, The Light is the Darkness. The idea of, it's kind of a body horror thing, although I have a strain of writing in the novella, the Imago Sequence novella, which the collection is named after, is one of the major ones. That at least that people, you know, identify with the transhumanism sort of aspect, the idea that we're evolving, and that there are, in the cosmic horror sense, Lovecraftian sense, I guess, that there are triggers that could cause punctuated, you know, equilibrium. That basically there could be some kind of outside force that would trigger a genetic marker and cause us to have some sort of transformation. And of course, I focus on Godhead, you know, characters who become, they don't just become other than human, they become superhuman. And then what happens after that, even? Well, it's actually I think it's a fair question to, you know, to assume maybe I wrapped it up, because a few years ago, I don't even remember what year now, but it was about 5 or 6 years ago, somebody asked me what, I think it was after the second collection, Occultation, and someone interviewed me, and they asked if I, you know, if I was worried about being typecast as a Lovecraftian or a cosmic horror writer, etc. And my response was essentially, I would rather have an identity than not have one, and then worry about what that means down the road. But at the time, I said, I'm kind of shifting as an author. I'm trying to, I don't want to do the same thing. I actually look at my career or my collections. I think of them as equivalent to albums that the bands, put together, or just individuals, singers. And the good musicians, either through their own foresight or because they have great management, they don't look at their career in the context of what they're doing at this very moment. They look at what they did last year. They try to look at it the long haul. Once you start getting published, then you can start thinking about things such as, okay, what am I doing with the next book? You don't make any assumptions that there's going to be one, but you have to plan for there being another one. What is your answer? If you're called upon to do another, lucky enough to do another book, another novel, collection, whatever. And so at the time, I was definitely feeling nothing external, but more of an internal yearning to not necessarily stop writing, what had given me success, but more along the lines to expand what I was writing about. And because the thing is my influences are very, very broad. And horror is actually, I would say, a subset, a very fractional influence, more so the last few years. But early in my career, and throughout my life, I should say, I was actually far more influenced by men's adventure, like H. Rider Haggard kind of stuff, modern stuff or contemporary stuff like Robert Ludlum, and then science fiction guys, Heinlein and Zelazny, and people like that. And horror was always there, but it was sort of in the background. And I think the real me, the hindbrain, is very powerful in me, and that definitely wants to dance a jig with horror. And so that's what I ended up doing. I found it took me many years, but I figured out after a million words throughout my youth that the dark side is where I belong. Hmm. But circling back to what this gentleman's asking me is just I had basically said, I think I may be done. It was probably one of the silliest things I've ever said, because it didn't show much foresight, because I was operating under a zero-sum sort of mentality, a philosophy, that I have to give up this to proceed into writing crime. Some of my early influences, like I said, I'd love to write a Western. I want to write a crime novel. Actually, I have written a crime novel. I'd like to write another one. But what I've discovered, though, because I've been lucky enough to be successful enough to do this, is I write full-time now. I don't have to give up transhumanism expression, following that thread. I don't, The Light is the Darkness was not the final word. A lot of my work ties together in kind of an intricate mosaic fashion, but there's more than one universe. These stories sort of, some of them are on track in universe A, other stories are on a track in universe B, and some of them they intertwine. And I do that for multiple reasons, but one is so that I don't have to limit my options. I mean, it's a big headache for me to keep track of it all sometimes, but it allows me to say, no, Light of Darkness wasn't the final word. It may have been the final word in Universe A, but Universe B, we haven't even begun to explore that track.
So how many universes would you say you have, Laird? Is it two main universes that kind of intertwine?
No, okay. There's... the thing is, I don't want to be too... I don't want to... It's not so much I don't want to be backed in the corner, but I've learned already that limiting, pronouncing some kind of limitation is ridiculous. So at this point, though, it's fair to say that most of my work veers back and forth between two primary realities. And I am happy to say that, because a lot of people are at the point where they're trying to sort of codex some of these stories, and I want to play fair with them so that they actually have something to go on.
Right.
Right.
It's interesting.
Mike, on the next one. Sorry?
I think you got the next one, right?
Yeah. Are you done with those prizes? Did we go through those four? The crony,
that's right. Yeah. Now we're on the beautiful thing that awaits us all, signed and personalized hardcovers. So.
And this is from a guy by the name of Nick Gucker. I'm not sure how he snuck in.
I've heard of that guy. He's kind of a goofball, but he's all right.
Yeah, really talented goofball.
Yeah, his art is just getting better and better.
Like I say, he's some kind of artist, right?
I've heard.
Some kind of talented artist guy.
Yeah.
He's great to talk to, though.
Nick Gucker is so nice that he makes all the rest of us look like assholes. So well, Nick's question is, when you were in a rough spot of survival during your Iditarod dog sled race, were you visited upon by something other?
You know, that's, I don't know. I do know that I had a couple strange, inexplicable experiences. I won't say inexplicable to me. I'm sure that there are authorities out there that could explain exactly what happened. I had an out-of-body experience in 1991, Iditarod. I got trapped only about 80 miles from the finish line of the race. Now, the race is about 1,100 to 1,200 miles long, depending on the route. And I was trapped, about 9-10 hours from the finish, after 2 weeks. So near yet so far. And the way that the trail goes outside of White Mountain, which is that famous Johnny Horton song, North to Alaska, talks about a little southeast of Nome. Well, that's where I was. And a storm, I was assured that, oh no, the skies would be clear, because I've been going through storm after storm. But lo and behold, I get out there for a couple hours, and this, basically a hurricane-level storm pinned me down. So it was, the winds were, it was in the negative 40s Fahrenheit. I ended up freezing my right foot solid in places. They were going to amputate chunks of it, which is another story entirely. They didn't, but to this day, my foot, isn't really all that great. But I froze my right foot to the point where I could walk barefooted on tile, and it sounds like Red Astaire tap dancing. And I froze my face, so my face was, black, had a crest of black on it. Froze a bunch of my fingers, et cetera, and so forth. The dogs came out much better. They got lucky. We all got lucky, but I came out much worse for the wear. It took me several years to recover. But what happened was I just piled the dogs in a pile, and the reason I did it is because I couldn't see more than about 3 feet. A friend of mine had given me, he's an ARCO executive at the time, and he had been caught in some blizzards up in the North Slope, way farther north than Nome even. And he had given me this little, not a flare, but a, it was a little light. It's like a lamp. It almost looks like something that would be blinking on the wing of a jet. You don't want to look at it directly. You couldn't look at it directly. Burn your eye. And the winds were blowing so hard that when I opened my sled to crawl in, it took some of my equipment and just flung it. I had a hand axe that weighs about a pound and a half, 2 pounds, and it took off end over end on the ground. And I had to get it or I would be disqualified. You have to have certain mandatory gear or you're not allowed to finish without it. So I set that beacon on the nose of the sled, and I went looking for I probably walked about 15, 20 feet, and I found the axe. It was up against a bank of snow. Grabbed it. I turned around, and there was no beacon. Just all there was just white. And I took a couple steps, nothing. And so of course, you can't follow your tracks because, there are no footprints. It's just gone. There's either glare ice and rocks, or there's drifts of snow. And it was blowing so hard that when the gusts hit, I actually had to go to a knee because I couldn't stand up. It would knock me down. So it took me about 5 minutes, but I started walking back to where I thought the sled had been. And I caught out of the corner of my good eye, I caught this flash of light, and I looked. I was going not in the opposite direction, but I was going like a 90-degree angle away from that light. But I'd gotten close enough that I just saw it barely flicker through the clouds. And so I walk over there, and of course it's blinding. And so I get in the sled and proceed to basically almost die over the next 36 hours. And the very strange thing that happened to me is I had never been to Nome before. And so I had this, I passed out at some point, and then I came to, and the storm abated, I got in the back of the team, and then I sort of passed out, next thing I knew I was in Nome, and they were thrusting microphones in my face. Everybody thought that I had died or was in danger of dying, and they were quite correct. And it was so real. It was more real than this conversation we're having. I could see the breaths puffing from people's mouths. When the guy was talking to me through the microphone, it was booming in my ears. You know, it was painful, and the light was painful. And then all of a sudden, this gust of wind came up. It was a bright, sunny day, and it covered everything. And I came to, and I was still in my sled. I was still, trapped. Huh. And what was really funny is, you know, a few hours later, the storm abated, and it took me like 9 hours trudging into Nome. That exact scene. So it's not really weird, but I will tell you the out of body experience is a strange, you know, a strange and powerful event. And it actually informed my writing. It still informs my writing to this day because it's going to sound crazy, but every now and then, especially when scientists start talking about the many Earths theory, that there are multiple universes, that possibly when you die in one, you just pick up in another one at the same exact moment. That's what deja vu is. That's what matrix glitches are, is that, you know, you just continually persist in alternate universes. For years, I was not able to shake, especially in my nightmares when I went back to it, I wasn't able to shake the idea that I died. But I never did get out of that. But never my father, you know, we were estranged even back then, but he came up and hugged me, you know, when I got back. And he said, we thought you died. He knew the equipment that I had. He knew how cold it was. It was so cold that I had ski goggles, and you touch them. I touched them, and they crumpled and shattered. This eye patch here, you know, it's made out of nice, sturdy material. I would be able to take that between thumb and forefinger and turn it to powder. I could powder it by doing that. That's how cold it was.
Wow.
And my father was sure that you know, how could you and your dogs have survived? How could that, you know, you should not have been out there, and it was a life or death situation. And, you know, sometimes I wonder.
That's a true man story right there. That's that's a character builder. My God. So you have part of you that feels like, maybe you never left, and this is all part of your subjective reality. Then that's a lingering thought in your mind.
It is, you know, it's not worth obsessing over, because if this is just subjective reality, then, you know, I've had plenty of incidents since then. I've been kicked in the balls enough times since then that it's real enough. But
I feel real.
I refute it thus. Yeah.
But I have to say, you know, I've been cursed with nightmares since I was a child. I have recurring nightmares. There go weeks where I can't really sleep because of nightmare, you know, dream time activity. It's still, you know, it is. It's a form of post, you know, traumatic stress syndrome. I go back to that sled bag that I was in. Just one last thing about it. I woke up at one point, because you dare not strip down. I was wearing, you know, my parka and all the stuff. So I dared not strip down. My feet, my right foot froze. The reason that it froze is because I was wearing those old military Air Force bunny boots. They're big white boots, and they actually have a little navel in them that you can, needle in them that you can adjust for air pressure. Somewhere along the line, it had sliced open on the ice, and so you could see my foot. I could see my foot through it. So I had no, you know, and so I got into my sled bag. I wrapped myself in this very nice $400 sleeping bag that somebody had given me to, you know, let me borrow. I woke up at one point, and the sled bag, I had it gripped in a death grip, and it was levitating like a magic carpet about a foot off the ground, going down, basically the wind was trying to take it. And it was so tight that my arms were, you know, I was, imagine like having a kite, you know, that's being pulled away by a hurricane. And, you know, I still dream about that sometimes.
You know, this whole story makes me want to ask you about your thoughts on solipsism.
Anything in particular? Or?
Well, I have the same thoughts occasionally, and it's nothing you can really take seriously, but every once in a while, you hope you can't.
Well, I don't want to go into it too deep. It's probably a private conversation, but I will say that I dwell on this stuff. And luckily, I'm able to squeeze the lemons in the lemonade, but I do think it is my curse at 4 in the morning to dwell on these kinds of things. But I got to tell you something. It's not for fear of what could have happened to me, what has happened to me. I will carry the scars forever. It's, to this day, I'm angry that my team was put in that situation because the radar operator said, oh, you're, you know, I'm not blaming the guy, but I was told it was safe. I wouldn't have gone. They said, I'll sit here for another, you know, I was out of the money. I didn't care. I was like, you know, I the last money position had just gone away from me. So I was like, you know what, I can sit here for 12 hours. You know, it's no longer competitive. I don't, because to me, the money went from first through 20th position. There were 80 people in the race. If you're not in the money, I've never been the kind of person to care about the difference between 21 and 41. It's enough to have finished it. That was the only goal at that point. It was for me and my dogs to finish it safely.
Right.
And we almost died. But you know, it's funny because I look back and when I say that I have sleepless nights and nightmares, a nightmare almost never has anything to do with the danger I was in. I'm quite at peace with that. I just am, you know, terrified of what could have happened to my team.
Wow. Well, the next question is from one Dean K, and he will also be winning The Beautiful Thing That Awaits Us All, signed and personalized hardcover. And his question is a classic and essential. What author, living or dead, is your greatest influence?
My greatest influence. I know there's another question that kind of circles around to this too later. So, Roger Zelazny. For those of you out there that might want to look him up, I recommend Lord of Light. He's famous for his amber. His Nine Pins is an amber series, whether it's 5 books in that one, and then several more, The Trumps of Doom. This Immortal. A bunch of others. A lot of short fiction. If you would have seen my writing 15 years ago, it would have been very apparent that Roger Zelazny was my big influence. And actually, and I really kicked myself, I think if it ever comes, well, when it comes out again, I think I'm going to put this in. The Light is the Darkness that was mentioned in a question or two ago is sort of an homage to him. There are a lot of ticks and sort of intricate details and sort of like double crosses, triple crosses, quadruple crosses. Constantly, it's almost like a hall of mirrors in the sense of what the villains and heroes' motivations are. Who really are, you know, who really is a good guy? Who really is a bad guy in the story? Are there any good guys in the story? That was all sort of genuflection to Zelazny. Zelazny, really, really important to my development. You know, my education was very poor. My family didn't. My dad didn't really value education. Luckily, my education, you know, I shouldn't say luckily. Luckily, we had tons of reading material and very little TV, no computer games, nothing like that back in the 70s, 80s. And so he taught me how to write. Him and Clavell and Michener, Andre Norton, Heinlein, people like that. But above them all, Roger Zelazny, because he has this very lucid, even, you know, and I choose that word specifically because his writing is actually often considered baroque and almost, you know, he goes into these stream of consciousness kind of digressions. But at the core of it, he is one of the most lucid, transparent writers that's ever, you know, in fantasy, and that all his pyrotechnics are sort of tricks in your own mind. I remember once reading the Nine Princes of Amber, or was it the Guns of Amber? Nine Princes of Amber, where they tried to take Amber.
Yeah.
And I remembered it as, you know, when he was talking about leading his army through shadow. We lost 500 men in the jungle where the, you know, where the natives were red and 7 feet tall, and we lost 300 men on an ocean, and we lost 75 more crossing some plains. But I remembered it as being very baroque and very detail-oriented, heavy in the detail, that this had to go on and on. But then when I went back to the book, you know, because I read it initially like when I was about 11, I tried to read it when I was 7 or 8. It went over my head. But I read it the first time when I was 11 or 12, somewhere in there. And I went back to it again in my teens. And I was stunned. That book's a skinny book. That book is a, it's actually The Nine Prints of Amber. I'm not even sure it surpasses a novella. If it does, it's by inches. And you're talking in the 40,000 word range, maybe something like that, maybe a little more. But those scenes and those vivid images were not conjured by this sort of dogged dedication to describing every leaf. No, he just threw a few. He understood that when you describe something, you just hit a few points. Well, actually, that's another trick I learned from him. I learned, you know, when you describe a character, it is unnecessary to describe more than two or three details at a time. And that, you know, and I went back and I looked at what he was doing. You know, some of his most important characters, he'd say, a large man with a beard resting green under the room. And if that was an important character, later on you'd find out that he wore a patch. Or later on you'd find out that he had a limp, or that one leg was longer than the other. But he would parcel those things out, and you would build this powerful image in your mind, and that's how he really approached everything. He would basically give you a skeleton with one or two distinct features, and then your subconscious did the rest. And most people, if I don't bring it up, will assume, oh, it's Lovecraft, or it's McCarthy, you know, whomever. And I have many powerful and profound influences, but it always circles back to Roger.
That's for as far as Roger goes, it's just kind of cool because growing up, my dad would always tell me about the Amber series, and it's one that I always intended on kind of circling back to, and you're making me think about trying to jump back into it at some point. But he seemed to be an
influence. I just reread it a couple of months ago. I was in a bookstore and happened upon, there's a two-volume set with all five books, and now
they're all right.
And also Trent, Roger Zelazny's son, just released the Amber, at least the first five books, I believe. I'm not sure about the second five, on Kindle, for all the Kindle users out there.
Oh, nice.
So,
yeah, Trent's going to be joining us for the Stanley Hotel Writers Retreat this year in Colorado. It's a little event that we have going on every October now. So,
well, he's a nice guy. As a matter of fact, he's going to be on this show a week from Sunday. We're going to talk with him, and I think you're going to be here too, Laird.
I'd love to be.
Yeah, he's a great guy. First of all, he's also a crime writer. He's not just a guy who's.
Oh, I've read his work.
Pardon me.
I've read some of his work.
Yeah, he's a great writer. We're going to talk about his stuff, and we're going to talk about, of course, his dad's stuff too. So, let's see. My turn. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't think this person has a name. I'm not going to try and pronounce this. the question, though, is your legendary death. What is it? What way would you choose to abandon your rotting flesh cage and take your place amongst the stars?
The thing is, I no longer. I enjoy that question. I mean, you kind of have to have that question. I don't want one anymore. There was a time where I would have said something like, you know, racing the Iditarod, or you know, do what the old mountain men did and crawl up on a cliff somewhere with the eagles feast on my bones. So, you know, Laird today, he doesn't want to. I don't want a legendary death. A meaningful death would be nice, and hopefully minimal pain. However, in my more adventurous days, back when I was racing sled dogs, and even a few years after I got out of it, I had a fascination, and it manifested in a story called The Forest, which is the lead story in Occultation, about this place. And actually, I don't have it right in front of me, but basically, it's in Bangladesh. It's called the Sundarbans Preserve, I think is what it's called. And it's a sort of, it's kind of an island. In effect, but it's like a big mangrove swamp, and it's flooded with salt water, and everything there is inimical to human life. Even the deer, which are the most innocuous creatures there, there's just like white-tailed deer, they've adapted to drink salt water. But the channel is patrolled by tiger sharks up to 18 feet. The mud that you have to, if you were to be wading around in the channels, there are some kind of reeds that stick up out of the mud that are so slender and so sharp that they can actually travel through your foot and out the top.
Oh.
Legend has it, you don't feel it.
Yikes.
Yeah. They all are tugging in your foot. There are leeches, and we're talking about the big ones, my favorite type. There are killer bees. People have been killed by bees there. There are boa constrictors, various constrictors, I mean, and big ones. We're talking about the 20, 25 footers. Everything, all these predators are man-eaters, but what it's famous for, or infamous for, because it's off limits, but locals will cross over there to do wood cutting and various things, and probably some illicit hunting. Hunters have gone over there looking for the water. There's some kind of a water buffalo that kills, a few hunters every time they go out, which I totally enjoy. But the tigers are like something out of a Michael Bay, basically almost cartoonish like concept. They are man hunters. They have they're much like polar bear. They just have no fear of men. And the locals will put, this is like from the 90s. I haven't researched it lately. I don't know what's going on these days. But back then, the locals would wear masks that would put a face in the back of their head to try to, because they believe that the tigers, if they saw your face, would, because they very seldom attack from the front. They come up behind, they grab their prey by the back of the neck, and they drag them off. And one of the, I don't know if it's apocryphal or not, but one of this big National Geographic article I was reading talked about how a group of explorers or surveyors or whatnot had been traveling down one of the rivers, and a tiger followed them for 2 days in the water, swimming behind them. And it would go up to the shore, and it would sleep. And they were traveling, like on these flat-bottom paths. And what it wanted to do, what they do, is they wait till people are sleeping, they climb up in there, and they grab somebody and drag them off. So I have a fascination with that place. So at the time, I was like, if I ever... Because I'm a cancer survivor, and that's how I lost my eye when I was a kid. And I thought, if I'm ever, this is my 20s, I thought to myself, that would be a great place. You go in there and you never, if you're terminal, you go in there and you don't come back. You give it up in the most savage place on the planet. I no longer have that sort of, fantasy, but I certainly am fascinated with the region, and I probably write a novel about it, actually, a prequel to the forest one of these days.
Okay, let's...
I'm on the guy is old man painlessly in your bed, death myself, but... yeah, I'm sorry, Chris, go ahead.
Oh, sure. Let's see here. Dan Lower, or Lauer, will there be any more tales about Lancaster and or Dr. Christo?
Those are, for people out there who may not have read The Siphon, which initially appeared, it's a novelette, almost a novella, it's a pretty long story. It appeared in Ellen Datlow's Blood and Other Cravings a few years ago. Lancaster is the protagonist, possibly a serial killer. And Christow is a professor who's kind of at the heart of this mystery that unfolds. And this might be the shortest answer of all the things I've given. Lancaster, how should I put this? I never say no to any of the characters, especially dead ones, being revisited. I love the idea of the alternate universe. I love the idea of writing prequel stories. A character dies in a story, but years later I write something. The character died in 2010. I'll write a story about the character. What was he doing in 1975, if it strikes me. But it's very unlikely that you'll ever see those two again. And if you do, it'll probably only be in a... Christow more than Lancaster, because I have thought about... Christow had some really strange experiences that he alluded to during a dinner party scene in the novelette. And it might be... possibly like 25% chance I'll eventually get the time to go and actually do some kind of a major story about the events that he alluded to. Lancaster, you might see him again in passing, but I don't think I'll ever do another story about him.
Well, as a follow-up, can you talk about anything that you're working on now or what's going to be published in the near future?
I'm working multiple things. That's why I'm not getting any sleep right now, but one of them is something to do with some abyss anthology. I can't remember. I was hoping to have it done by now, but I'm in the middle of that. I'm pretty excited about it. I have so many other things. I'm not going to get into it. This is the I Am the Abyss night, and so I'm going to say, the people who haven't read my material, it's going to be a big novella. It's definitely an afterlife novella. This will be very upfront in the story, so I'll go ahead and reveal this. It's inspired by, it's not based upon, it's inspired by a serial killer named Kraft, who operated in the late 70s through the early 80s. He was called the Scorecard Killer. You can look him up. I don't suggest doing it, though, unless you have a strong constitution. And for those of my fans out there who are familiar with my work, it is in the Jessica Mace mythos. It has nothing to do with Jessica, but it has a lot to do with a boyfriend of hers who passed away terribly tragically. And I'm working on a number of things. That's, of course, a major, that's consuming a lot of my attention. Another novella that I'm working on, actually basically done with, is I'm doing one for Journalstone. It's kind of an odd thing, so I'm kind of glad to be able to talk about this. I wrote Aaron French a story about Azathoth for his Gods of H.P. Lovecraft. And of course, as I am wont to do, it's not so much really about Azathoth, but Azathoth is in there. But we're also going to have a part two. It's about a 10,000, 11,000 word novelette that will be in that anthology. And it has an end, but there's definitely potential for there to be more. I'm actually writing a series of stories about these two characters. They're basically the anti-Hardy boys, the Toombs brothers, that are the protagonists and antagonists of the story. And so the second half of it, he asked me if I would, can you basically break the story in such a way that it has an ending, but also picks up and you have, like another 15,000, 10,000 to 15,000 words. So that's what we're doing. So there'll be the novelette, which is called We Smoke the Northern Lights. But then there's part two, which is the whole thing. And it's called X's for Eyes. And it'll be about about 25,000, between 22 and 25,000 word novella, So that's another major thing that I'm working on. Between now and 2016, I have probably 20 to 25 stories coming out. And the other big thing that's happening is one of my stories from Occultation, a story called 30, which is basically a newspaper term. We used to put 30 at the end of articles or essays or whatnot. Takes on a whole new meaning in that story, but it was optioned for film. Reno Productions, production company, they've done a few things. They picked it up. A brilliant, brilliant writer named Philip Gillat. He was the writer, the lead writer on an independent film a couple years ago called Europa Report. It was it was very well received, very well written. I've seen the script. It's a brilliant script. They've actually cast it and are going to be filming it any day now. So
awesome.
That's a wonderful. I'm really excited about that. I'm sort of cynical about the whole movie thing. I enjoy that people think enough of my work to do it. I certainly, as a full-time writer, the money is definitely critical. But I sort of had given up any hope of expectation that they're going to do a good job. Because I've had a lot of my stuff looked at, I've had a lot of things optioned over the years, and every now and then you get a good script, but most of the time, it's not because it's changed, it's just because it's terribly written. This guy really is a great writer, and I'm really excited, and I hope everything goes well, but this is a pretty thrilling, not for the movie itself, but just for the fact that I think he's going to do such a great job with it, so I wish him and his, I wish him and his production company and the cast the best of luck. I know it's arduous because it's a wilderness story. They're going to have to film in the woods, a great deal of it. And so I wish them the best of luck on it.
Does he have any kind of, at this early point, any kind of ideas on when the movie will be out? Any dates?
No. That pretty much holds you all I can reveal. And mostly because we just don't, they have to get through the production, and that's, like I said, it's no joke. It's an arduous process. There's a lot of things that can, you know, they go into that, and so we're way away. They're way away, I should say, from being able to predict when it would possibly come out. I'm thinking next year, though. I'm hoping so.
Okay. Looks like the next couple of questions are a couple of writing questions. Eugene Kelly, are you still on the same prize, Chris? What's he got?
Yeah, this is actually the last guy that's going to win, last person that's going to win a prize, and then the rest are just the runner-up questions that we decided to toss in there. So.
Okay. All right. Eugene Kelly wants to know, or says, I'm starting a horror/weird fiction universe of my own. I was wondering if you had some general tips on how to best go about this.
Yeah, I think I felt like we need a couple writing mechanical questions. I just want to preface this by saying, in general, I don't believe in prescriptive advice. I mean, it's unavoidable in a lot of ways, but I think you basically have to sort of take it in a contradictory fashion, or look at it like best practices. Yeah, but ultimately you find out what works for you. The main reason I want to answer this question is it touches on something that I find is very important in my own writing and what I respect and enjoy amongst my comrades that are doing this. We don't need Lovecraft 2.0. We don't need Poe 2.0. It's fine to wear your influences on your sleeve. I think because we are in dialogue as artists with everyone who's ever, you know, written and published, you know, you are in a conversation with those people. That's fine.
Laird, are you getting an echo?
Yeah.
Chris, hit your mute button, would you? You know where that's at?
Yeah.
Let me see the one on your end. I think that will probably fix it.
Yep. This is it's not really complicated, but it's just a little bit tricky. I believe in the ecstasy of influence. A lot of my comrades, and not just in this field, but in our genre, but other, worry about that a lot. They worry about, oh, I sound too much like Roger, his last name. Oh my God, what if I sound too much like Robert McCarthy? Or they're maybe embarrassed because they love the pulps, and the pulps really are what fuels their literary, their elevated thriller, as the industry likes to call it now. On one hand, I think you absolutely are best served to embrace those, whatever it is you love, whatever it is that gets you high on doing this, whatever got you to read and propelled you to, I want to write like Ray Bradbury. I want to do, I'm in conversation with this guy. Here's my response to, Dandelion Wine or whatever, Martian Chronicles. That's wonderful. I think it's not only wonderful, it's essential. That said, we have Ray Bradbury, and we have Ray Bradbury's universe. And while it's one thing to write a story that's been commissioned for a Lovecraft anthology, especially one that's where they say, listen, we want you, like the one I'm in, where it talks about Azathoth, it's one thing to, with a cold eye, say, I'm going to write a story in that universe, a tie-in novel, whatever. It's another thing, though, to allow yourself, when you're creating your own universe, to mimic and sort of be a remora on the side of that shark. This great canon of weird fiction. You want to be indebted to it, and you want to express it, but you want to express it in your own way, and you want to, whatever you do I don't even think you have to be so lofty as saying, well, I don't want to advance it. That should be your ambition. Aim for the stars, you might get the side of the barn. But you definitely want whatever you do to be your own interpretation. And I think fixing your mind in that way will allow you to escape a lot of the pitfalls. Because writing Lovecraftian fiction, it is so easy to fall into parody or pastiche to the point where, and there's nothing really wrong with pastiche, but there are levels of pastiche. And, I think you got to be very careful about emulating your heroes to the point where you're simply a cover band. Don't,
Right.
Don't do that. My tip for not doing that is actually don't run away from them. I have two things. One, you need to have many, many influences outside of, in weird fiction, it's a much smaller canon. You know, even if we broaden the umbrella and say, oh, well, let's bring in McCarthy as a horror writer type of thing. The point is, it's a very small spectrum, or short spectrum. Your influences need to be as broad as possible. You need to be as well-read as possible. And that will, you know, that will permit you to basically pick and choose aspects from many, many artists and find your own way.
All right, I'm gonna unmute here.
Yeah, five questions. Those were the winners, and the next five questions are the runners up, and we're gonna ask Laird those questions as well.
Correct. Yeah, exactly. And if it's cool, I'll just quickly run over the 10 winners again, just in case anybody missed their question or announcement. But the 10 people who won signed and personalized books from Laird are Jed Latchrist, Heath Wolfeld, Adam Alexander, Edwin Labes, Robert Adams, Nick Gucker, Dean Kay, somebody whose name I'm not so sure of, Wistful Deditious, Dan Lower, and Eugene Kelly. So you guys have all won signed and personalized books from Laird, and thank you very much for the interesting questions.
Yes, yeah, I'd just like to jump in. Thank you, everybody out there, for asking the questions. I enjoyed reading them.
Yeah, we really got some good ones, and I've found I think any Laird Barron fan would find this very insightful and interesting. So, and we actually had more than we could really select. So, but we did decide to choose five runner-ups, and the first one is Paula Limbaugh, and her question is, what do you find to be the hardest thing about writing?
It's changed over the years. It used to be the discipline, you know, facing the blank canvas. I used to have a difficult time, even though I've always been imaginative. Up until about 7-8 years ago, I always had in the bank, you know, I'm writing a story, and I always had in the bank, you know, the old mental storage bank, I might have 2 or 3 other. I don't mean fleshed out, in other words, I know exactly what's going to happen, but I would have 2 or 3 other very, you know, fully realized sort of vibrant ideas. And it was very difficult for me for a long time to train my subconscious and train my imagination, and the subconscious, I think, is the vast engine that runs your imagination. It took me a long time to learn how to train it, to provide me with sort of the steady stream of ideas. Because I do keep a journal every time something, whether it's a fragment of a dream, a fragment of a conversation, something I read on the internet, it could even be a paragraph, like the first paragraph of a story, I write that stuff down. But it's a lot more intimate and complicated than simply just keeping a list of ideas. Those ideas just don't disappear on me. I had to train, and I thank John Langan for this. John Langan said this to a class of creative writers. You know, he's an adjunct at SUNY New Paltz. On top of being a great writer, he's also, you know, great educator, and I learned something. I'm sitting there, you know, I was just sort of, we were supposed to go do something after class, so I'm taking his class in the back there, and auditing, I guess, and he inadvertently, for me, he gave me one of the most golden nuggets I have ever stumbled across, and that was, you have to stop neglecting your subconscious. Your subconscious is where everything is coming from. It is the 9 billion cubic feet beneath the surface, you know, of the tip of the iceberg. And he said, you know, somebody asked him, well, how do you train it? And he said, well, first of all, you stop stunting it. You stop smacking your subconscious for in your imagination for ludicrous ideas. And I'm just paraphrasing him. He says, you imagine as a puppy, and the puppy's young, the puppy bounds up to you and brings you a shoe. Maybe you're trying to teach to fetch, and you're supposed to be fetching a stick, and the puppy's grabbing everything but the damn stick. He goes, and your instinct is to be frustrated, possibly. He goes, no. You encourage the puppy, and then you go, no, but the stick is what I really wanted. Which is, thank you for that moldy sock. Thank you for that apple core. Thank you for the cat, put the cat down. And the bottom line is, he said, if you encourage it and you give him a pat and you send him back out, go get me that stick or whatever, something interesting. He says, after a while, of not being stifled, he says, you know, if you smack it and say no, after a while it just kind of slinks away and isn't really participating with you to any great degree anymore. And you're like, where'd my dog go? You know, why isn't my dog playful? Where's that puppy? Because you want to keep your subconscious vibrant. You constantly say, thanks. Wasn't quite what I was looking for, but thanks. You don't dismiss it out of hand. And once I learned that, and that was like about 4 or 5 years ago, I had already kind of sort of was coming around to sort of developing that subconsciously, but that changed everything for me as far as making writing easier. Now I actually have, I honestly don't believe that if I just stop, and I can't stop, but if I stop now, assuming I have another 25, 30 years, you know, of writing, there's no way I could ever, you know, do justice to all the ideas that have swarmed in since I've started taking that seriously. So ideas were the biggest, from idea to execution, you know, used to be the toughest thing for me. These days, my biggest hurdle, thing that I have to overcome, is I don't compare myself to other writers. That's a fool's game. I compare myself to myself. Unfortunately, your critics also compare you to you. And so, after you achieve a certain level, you, whether it's critically or whether it's just in your own, you know, your own personal satisfaction, there's two components. One, there is a lot of pressure to not necessarily one up what you've done before, but you always feel like you need to be at your peak. And the fact of the matter is, writing is a very peaks and valleys kind of a, especially writing for a living, it's a very draining peaks and valley kind of a marathon. And so I've learned, you know, don't submit something just because it's a deadline. I have to hold on to this thing for another month, you know, sorry, Chris, you know, kind of thing. The other part is, and this is the far more dangerous part, if you're doing that, I think you're okay. And I think the best colleagues that I know, or the best writers I know do that, they're never quite satisfied, is be careful that you don't become satisfied with what you've done before. And that's a, you know, maybe that's more of a more advanced kind of a thought. But, you know, but the thing is never think that you're good enough. And I learned that from martial arts. I used to take martial arts for years. I learned that from weightlifting. And I damn well learned that from running dogs. No matter what you think you know, no matter how accomplished you are, you could improve. And you're fighting entropy. You know, you're fighting sort of the deleterious effect that gravity has on our bodies and our minds. So you should always be trying to punch above your weight. And the tough part is to remember that when you're in the middle of the fight, is to remember that there's a purpose to this whole thing.
Laird, just a quick follow-up question about writing, if you don't mind. I'm just curious, are you a writer who works at a certain time of the day or night, or is it just sporadic?
I work, should you not, between 12 and 18 hours a day. And it's not all, I mean, there's no way that I'm, like, clenched over the keyboard for 18 hours.
Right.
But I'm in this chair with small breaks to basically have a life. To fuel myself, for example, and to let my girlfriend know I'm still alive. I'm in the chair between 12 and 18 hours a day right now. This is an insane schedule. Normally what I do, and I'm hoping to get back to it in a few months, is my work day is about 10 hours. And it's not that it's a certain time, because I actually have no problem going, oh, we have to go to town to go do something. Or, very importantly, to feed that subconscious. There's a movie playing, we should go see it. I need to meet other people, because I'm reviewing for Locus now. I'm doing all kinds of nonfiction work and extracurricular stuff, which I find you need to exercise that, you know, other parts of your brain, just like the fiction engine stays lubricated. But I don't have a schedule. Stephen Graham Jones said it best. He goes, schedules just give you an excuse. You know, I missed my writing schedule today. Because it works like discipline. I'm just paraphrasing him. I'd have to go back. It was a brilliant essay he wrote about, or at least the comment that I honed in on. Basically, schedules are a bit of an albatross, a bit of an anchor, a bit of an excuse. You need to write your damn stories. And it's not at a certain time of day. It's when, you know, if that works for you, that's great. I'm not knocking that at all, by the way. If 9 to 5 is how you do it, if every 3 weeks you sit down and just write the story in a 24-hour heat, that's fine. But I definitely think there's a danger, unless you've established that a schedule works for you, I definitely think that it's something to be wary of.
I have a writing follow-up question, too. Do you keep a idea? Do you write down ideas or have a commonplace book?
Yeah, actually, that was sort of what I was talking about a few minutes ago. I have page after page of fragmentary ideas. And at first, I tried to make them very orderly. Now all I do is make sure that they're separate, that there's an asterisk beside each one to show, that there's this is where one idea begins and another one starts. But that's another thing I've trained myself to do. It's a lot harder to do than you think until you train yourself. Because every single time something pops into my head, and usually it's because I'm reading something online or I'm driving down the road and I see something, write it down immediately. I have stuff, and I've been doing this for several years, and I have a lot of stuff that I've never even thought about since, but it's there. And every now and then, something, there's just sort of this alloy effect. These things just sort of merge together, and all of a sudden I'm like, oh, wow, these three disparate ideas, one that I thought of in 2010, and one that I thought of in 2012, and one that I thought of 5 minutes ago, there's a story. Or there's an anecdote in the story. I'm an anecdote collector. I believe in verisimilitude in writing. I think that horror, and especially weird horror, can only truly be effective. I shouldn't say only. That's the wrong thing, because there are Edgar Rice, but there are people who are just fabulists, or surrealists who never even try to. Like, Mike Sisko doesn't care about prosaic reality, and he's very effective. So let me backtrack on that. I think in general, though, weird fiction works best if you deploy it in so that it contravenes mundane reality. In other words, you have to have some kind of, you have to basically be immersed in the world the author's creating for the horror to really take effect. I like to merge humor, if I can, occasionally, to counterbalance the horror. There has to be this counterbalancing effect. Horror and the weird, for me, unless it's like an epic fantasy or something, or a surrealist story. I actually sold a surrealist kind of story to John Joseph Adams recently for his What the Heck Is That anthology. But in general, I find that that the stuff that I respond to and the stuff that I think works the best in my own work is where it's very heavily grounded in the prosaic, and then you stick the shiv to it later, and they're like, there's escalation of tension in that way, or the way you use comedy to de-escalate tension. But there has to be, if it's just gloom, 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 or weird, 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 like a full frontal assault all the time, I think that works on an individual story basis, maybe a novel, but it's not. I don't think it's in as much as there can be a formula or a recipe for good writing or effective writing. I don't think it works as well as when you leaven it a bit or dilute it.
All right. Adam Thornsberg wants to know: does the Black Guide factor into any of your future works?
Yes. The Black Guide, and the Black Guide just isn't just a book. The Black Guide came into being during a drunken conversation that I had at a convention with Paul Tremblay and John Langan. I think it was ReaderCon. I'm not sure if Sisko was there. There might have been some other people there, but those are the two culprits, co-conspirators. And we all agreed that we were talking about the idea of the Black Guide. It's kind of like this travelogue or an almanac or a trail guide. And it's analogous to less to the Necronomicon, because people compare it to the Necronomicon. I'm like, no, it's not a book of darkest evil. It's more analogous to the idea of the Derlethian, mythos, where and people have come after Derleth, who are basically like, oh well, if there was a Necronomicon, then there was these tablets over here and this and the Book of Worms over there type of thing. And some of them weren't even books. Like I said, some were tablets, or there was runes carved on a wall somewhere. And so our idea was, it's analogous to the spirit of the idea of the sinister book, but not necessarily a diabolically evil book. And we agreed to each do a story. I think one of the ideas that Paul had is a couple is on a bus somewhere and they find it tucked in the flap behind the seat type of thing. And John had something else. But both of them have done things. Paul did a story about the barn in the wild that deals with the Black Guide. It's one of the more popular stories in the Children of Old Leech anthology. And John, you know, he took a completely different direction. He actually had a version of the Black Guide being online, you know, like a website that crashes your computer. You think it crashes your computer. Your computer goes black, thing shuts down. You know, and then you reboot it, and maybe it reboots, maybe it takes a day to reboot, whatever. But then a couple days later, all of a sudden, everything seems normal. All of a sudden, your computer screen, you know, kind of jumbles, and you're on the, you know, it's giving you this information that you had, you requested, you know, last week type of thing. So I don't see it disappearing in my work, and I'm sure that, you know, my colleagues and other colleagues are welcome to jump in on it. We'll be doing stories, you know, that feature in the future.
Okay. Yes, sir. I got Matthew Masuki. I don't know how to pronounce that. If you could resurrect one dead writer so that they could continue writing, who would it be and why?
And it goes right back to, you know, my big influence. That's Roger's last name. I would bring him back for selfish reasons. You know, one big regret I have in my life, he died when I was in my mid-20s, and I think it was basically this, right about the time that I actually left Alaska and moved to the West Coast, you know, Seattle. And I'd never been to a convention. I never wrote authors. You know, I never did the pen pal thing. But I really, you know, the guy got me through a terrible, not just me, but my two brothers. He got us through a horrible childhood, but specifically me and my middle brother. We really feel like, you know, that old saw that, oh, you know, there are musicians and there are artists and there are writers and actors who were there for you, whether they knew it or not. And Roger Zelazny was very formative, not just in my writing, but sort of in my early, you know, my team philosophy. You know, Roger Zelazny taught me that people who are stereotypical villains can do good things. He taught me that losing was not a dishonorable, that the only dishonor, you know, was in how we approach life and in the actions we took, but not in whether you won or lost a fight. And let me just tell you, my childhood was full of fights, and I lost my share. And Roger Zelazny, you know, and the thing is, you know, he dabbled in pop psychology, but that really wasn't, you know, that was just sort of window dressing. He was very much into, you know, these epic narratives. And I don't think, I never really took it as being a sort of a preachy, didactic sort of moral lesson I'm supposed to get from him. I think kids see through that stuff anyway. What I got from him was, it was like, it's okay to lose, man. It's okay to lose. You're going to lose. We all lose. And, yeah, I wish I could have shaken his hand.
I think that's you on the next one there, Mike.
Yeah, there is a, you mentioned, you were talking about Zelazny just now, there's a great scene at the end of, I think it's The Guns of Avalon, is that's the second book, I believe, where Eric dies and
yeah. Corbin
realizes that this guy he looked at as this horrible, horrible bad guy, maybe he wasn't really a bad guy after all, maybe he was just trying to protect Amber.
And him.
Yeah.
He was actually trying to protect. Yeah, he had him blinded and all this stuff, but you know, I don't want to give away a bunch of stuff, but yeah, perception. All these, you know, it's funny because I did this story called The Imago Sequence, and the psychiatric, at least an old version of the psychiatric term, was an idealized image that a kid will have of an adult that they maintain throughout their life and never changes. Daddy Warbucks, for little orphan Annie, is always going to be, you know, this jolly benefactor who rescued her, no matter what the reality is, no matter how her power position changes in life, you know, and he's sort of the opposite, though. You know, he kind of dispels that. He's like, he punches a hole in the idea of Imago. He's like, yeah, you have this, in some cases, idealized, other cases, the opposite of that viewpoint of people. Like, in that story, actually, that series, people that he thought that he loved and loved him back and that were worthy of his affection and ardor and whatnot turned out to be not, you know, not wholesome, not good. And so I really, you know, yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, it, without preaching, but just telling a story, you know, he really, I was having a very rough time in my teens, many of us are, and for many years, you know, my brothers and Roger Lasney were the only friends I had.
Well, all I can say is that I know exactly what you mean by that, and Zelazny is one of those people for me, and Bradbury's another one. You know, they never let you down. There were people that you counted on, people even that were supposed to protect you. You know, some of us growing up, and they might let you down, but Roger Zelazny didn't, you know?
So. Right.
Yeah, I think I have the next question. Thomas Pluck says, whether it was a story, an event, or a person, fictional or real, what frightened you the most when you were a child?
There was a few things. I've always had terrible dreams. I mentioned that earlier. And I've been able to take this negative aspect of my life, something that's really given me mental and physical grief since I was 4 or 5 years old, and do something with it. I don't necessarily directly get one-to-one ideas from dreams, but I've gotten enough and had success, monetarily and literary success. So I don't necessarily know what I would do if somebody said, "Hey, I'll take them away." But they were really, really bad when I was a kid, and I think part of that had to do with the circumstances I was being raised in, but also probably just genetics. You know, there's a lot of stuff going on both sides of my family tree, genetically, that could account for the nightmares. But that was a big problem when I was very young, and I think that would probably resonate because I recognize Thomas's name there, and I wrote a story for him recently, and he is a very outstanding advocate for people who are, innocents being abused. And so I think this would resonate with him, is that, I did not feel safe growing up. And ironically, my parents, they didn't, I'm not trying to say they were these evil people, nothing like that. It wasn't just them. The entire circumstances growing up was very frightening. And I have mental depression, and I'm sure I had it when I was a kid. And it's a kid in the 70s with acute mental depression. I'm not sure anybody would recognize it. I was recovering from cancer. That took me a long time to recover from. We lived for years with the fear that I would actually lose my other eye, because that's normally how it works. It goes into one and then attacks the other. And so for the first 12 or so years of my life, maybe longer, I was under the constant Damocles sword, is it going to come back? And so there are all these things going on. And of course, living in the woods, we didn't have any money. We basically had an app, the stereotypical clampet lifestyle during my late, my early to mid-teens, late teens. Holes in the roof, bears coming into the yard. My mom had to shoot a bear out of the tree because it was trying to come in the house. That kind of stuff really was on my... I carried a shotgun around when I was 11 years old, 10, 11 years old. We didn't go to the water hole some days without the shotgun. And my parents are not gun advocates. They're not Second Amendment. It was just a tool. The weapons were just a tool. And they were like, "You're going to get eaten by a bear, and I can't be there. Here's the shotgun with the double lock buck." Didn't think anything about it. You just did it. But that's a lot of weight on your, on you when you were a kid. And so it's a very pedestrian response, I guess, but that's, I had some weird stuff happen, too, when I was a kid, but, that's campfire tale time around a bottle of whiskey. But I would have to say, day-to-day living from the time I was about 9 until I was about 16 or 17, my biggest fear was, dealing with sort of these pedestrian experiences that you have in the woods. You're worried about getting hurt. That was the other thing. We constantly had to worry about, if you get hurt, there's nobody. Our nearest neighbor for many years was 20 miles away on a river. My dad, he's a pretty sarcastic guy. He goes, "Well, if you get hurt, if you and your brother jack around, you get hurt, you get cut, because I'm cutting firewood when I'm 11. If you chop yourself in the leg, you chop your brother in the leg, I'm just going to have to make a new kid, because we're not going to be able to get one." He goes, "I'm young." He goes, your mother and I are young. We can make new children." He goes, "So don't fuck about too much, because there's nobody here to help you."
That's what a great message for a child.
Maybe the man I am today.
How many siblings do you have, Laird?
I have two brothers. Jason, who lives in Montana, who's 2 years younger, and my youngest brother, William, who lives in Alaska, and he's six years younger. And
very cool. One more question.
Let me read these real quick. We've got a lot of people watching live, and I'm sure many more will be watching the recording. Just read a couple of them real quick. Leah says, not a question, but a thank you to Laird for suggesting McCarthy. I really enjoyed Blood Meridian. The languaging was just beautiful. Chad says, Laird's heart for dogs is one of my favorite things about him. Red of empathy. Empathy is the best measure of a man that I've ever found. And then this one's more practical. And for you, Chris, Eugene says, I want a book and got my question answered. Where do I go to put in my address for my book to be sent to me? So take that one.
Well, he will be emailed shortly after this broadcast, and we will be collecting everybody's shipping information. Laird was generous enough to donate the books. So first I'll be passing along the names of all the winners to him so that he knows who to personalize them to, although we do have one person that doesn't really have a real name, so they might just be out of luck. I'm not sure. But
if I could just jump in and say to everybody out there that's, you know, interested, you know, that got their questions answered, they're waiting for their books and whatnot, you'll have to work it out with Chris, but I'm happy to personalize them. And, you know, I'm not just going to sign them. If you need them personalized or would like them personalized specifically, I'm happy to do that too. So if you have, I generally have sort of some things that I do when I personalize stuff, but if you have something specific or if you need me to personalize it for some, like if this is for a family member or something, just pass the information on to Chris and I will make it happen.
Yep, exactly. I'll be emailing everybody tonight and requesting any information like that from them, and yeah, hopefully everybody will respond to us promptly and we'll get those sent out. But as Laird was touching on, thanks to everybody who submitted the questions. I thought we got really some high quality things that really got into some good discussions and some good insights. So but yeah, I think that we have just one question left, and that is from Brad West, and it is, what do you do to get inspiration when writer's block hits you?
I recognize it for what it is, at least in myself. I'm not callous enough to say, I've had colleagues say, oh, there's no such thing. No, I think some people do suffer from impotence of inspiration. The main thing that I do is I don't allow it to take root. Usually it takes root. Part of that's inactivity. Writing is a discipline. At least writing, you know, in my case, where I'm writing for a living, I'm writing every day. It's not a big deal for me. Matter of fact, I'd love to have a 2-week vacation. I'm hoping that happens. But in generally, throughout the course of the year, and you know, a lot of writers do daily word counts. I find that bogus. I'm not interested. It matters not whether I wrote one word today or whether I wrote 5,000. I look at it long term. It's a marathon. I'm not interested in what my time was the first mile. It's mile 10. Okay, I'm gonna take an assessment. Mile 18, mile 26. So I'm in it for the long haul. And so writing, I have a bad back. During my wasted youth, I injured my back very severely. And so sitting in the chair, there's all these excuses for me not to be doing my work. And so what I do is I try to work on multiple, practically speaking, I work on multiple projects at once. That way, if I'm stumped, and I've come up with a lot of tricks to deal with, like if I'm stumped on one story, you skip ahead, type of thing. But something that doesn't work. So I try to work on not a lot of things at once, but at least 2 to 3 items at once. That way, if for whatever reason I just can't get purchase on the narrative and story A, I can jump over to story B, and usually it's something completely different. Even though I do work within a spectrum, I do have different modes of writing that I've developed over the years. And so I've got this weird surrealist thing going on over here, but it's not coming together for me. Instead of forcing it, I'll go over here and write my noir Lovecraftian, you know, 1920s story. If that's not working, guess what? I've got one about this robot dog that likes to bite people's faces off. I'll work on that one. And I find that's all I need. That and the ever-present, you know, knowledge that if I don't get things done, that I'm not able to have my internet or my lights or my dinner.
Great. You know, I guess I just have one follow-up question since we're talking about writing right now. You and I were talking a little bit about Spider Robinson before we started the show, which makes me want to ask you I guess every writer would probably answer this differently, but what does being a successful writer mean to Laird Barron? What has to happen for you to consider yourself a success?
You know, actually, it's already happened. I have these, you know, when I first started out writing, what it meant to me, I was 5 years old, it meant to tell stories and to put them on paper. When I became a little older, a little more sophisticated, there was a time in my teens, we didn't get into this, but I, you know, from the time I was 6 years old to the time I was about 21, 22, and then there was a gap after that, I wrote over 1 million words and all kinds of stuff, and very little of it was horror. I didn't have a focused goal except just to write. I actually, it was a very pure experience. You know, these days it's about, I have a deadline, I have really these very concrete goals, and some of them are monetary, and other ones are, well, you know what, I've always wanted to write, you know, I need to tie this story to the other, you know, it's a practical kind of thing. When I was a kid, it was simply the pure joy, and I think it's, athletes probably will tell you this. When they were nine, most athletes when they were nine, they weren't thinking about being world champions except in an abstract way. Of course, we all say that. We say, oh, I want to be the next Stephen King, or I want to be the next Roger Zelazny. That's something you say, but when you're young, with exceptions, with rare exceptions, you're doing it mostly, though, because you just fucking love it. You say you want to become Stephen King, but that's not, you're not getting rejections every day and going, oh, I'll never be Stephen King, and if I'm not, I'm a loser. Or you're a kid that's just like, I'm awesome, man, and someday I'm going to be like Stephen King. That's what it was for me. Well, I started developing milestones, and the milestones, some are practical and some are just inspirational. To be reprinted by Ellen Datlow, to be published by Ellen Datlow, who's one of the, you know, is going to be a legendary, you know, she'll have her Hall of Fame entry in our genre for many reasons. You know, it was to be published, then it was to be reprinted, and then it was to have, you know, after years and years, well, maybe someday, you know, somebody will do a special edition of one of my stories. But you know what the biggest thing that's happened for me that's made me feel like a success is I've had, man, it just chokes me up a little bit. When I was a kid, I didn't write a letter to Roger Zelazny, and God help me, I wish I would have. But if I go back in time, yeah, I would have written a letter to Roger Zelazny and said, thanks. And you know what? You know, thanks for getting through this horrible, horrible fucking childhood. These horrible things that have happened. At least I had that little candle in the dark. Well, I've gotten a couple letters like that. I've gotten letters from people who said, you know what? My life just went to shit. I got divorced. I lost my job. All these horrible things happened. And I read, you know, Occultation or The Croning or whatever, and man, you know, thanks. So everything else is just gravy.
That's incredible. I think that's a great note to end on.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, Laird, for taking the time tonight.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Chris. I Am the Abyss comes out, late next year, if I remember correctly?
Yeah, first let me just say thank you to Laird for being so generous with your time and with the books that you're donating to the fans. You know, I know a lot of people that are watching really appreciate that, and all the insights and advice you gave, it means a lot. So just thanks for doing this, Laird, and thanks again to everybody who submitted questions and participated and watched, and it's all been fantastic. Went on for longer than I thought, but at the same time, it kind of went by in a flash because I was just so enthralled with everything that Laird was saying. But Well, I think that, that wraps it up. So as far as I Am the Abyss goes, we're on Kickstarter until this coming Tuesday, September 22nd. So that's the last day, 10 p.m. Pacific time, Tuesday night. And as I said earlier, Laird's working on a new novella for the book. And we've got Caitlin R. Kiernan in there. We got Jeffrey Thomas, Reggie Oliver, Caitlin Patrick Burke, Nicole Cushing, several very talented authors and artists. And the book is on Kickstarter until Tuesday, September 22nd, 2015. It'll be out for retail sale in the fourth quarter of 2016. So if you're watching this after the date, after the Kickstarter is over, just look for it in the fourth quarter of 2016. So, but thanks again. And thank you, Mike, by the way. I mean, thanks for hosting the whole thing and for everything you do with Lovecraft eZine. It's an important service to the community. So,
well, I will make can't think of the number of Laird Barron fans who will love listening to this in the future and all the everything that Laird had to say. I will also make this available as a audio podcast in the near future as well, so I'll announce when that happens. So, Laird, really appreciate you taking the time tonight and everything you had to say.
Well, thanks for having me on.
And thanks, everyone, for watching. And we'll be back for the regular showtime Sunday at 6 o'clock Eastern. So thanks.